your source for everything paranormal. Para-X. The views expressed and the opinions given by the individual host and their guests do not necessarily reflect those of Para-X, its affiliates, or its sponsors.
Supernatural.
Everyone, this is Jerry with The Calling, along with the one, the only, Kimberly Juarez. Boy, that was sexy, wasn't it?
Hi, Jerry. How are you?
Doing well. Yourself?
Doing good. Doing good. Good. Weather's good. Nice right now. No storms, which is good.
That's true. It's looking good out there. There is a couple clouds that just started forming in. Oh, this is it. End of days. So there. Hey, who do we have on tonight?
We have Valentina on tonight.
I like to call her spiritual medium Valentina Lomborg Wiley.
That's long.
What's up, V? How you doing? So I heard you got a new addition to the family.
Yes, it's a toy Yorkie. She's downstairs right now, probably wreaking havoc somewhere.
How much havoc can such a small
little teeth, tiny little. Well, because she tends to see what she can get away with. Like if she's on the bed, I have all these, all these scarves and things. And all of a sudden I turn my head and I look and it's not a ghost, but it's being pulled across the bed. She's pulling the curtains and she's always doing something. There's a lot of me saying no going on.
So how old is she?
5 months.
Oh, she's tiny.
She is a baby.
Yeah, she's full size. She's four pounds, but she's already full size, even though she's a puppy. So,
oh my gosh!
Wow.
Just yeah, I mean she's like yay big. So,
and Lyra went to Seven's house.
Yeah, Lyra, my cat, went to my son Seven's house because Lyra started hissing at the puppy and then started hissing at me if I was, no matter what I was carrying, because she thought I was carrying the puppy. So I said, I don't need the drama. I've had 7 years with this cat and the cat's not really very snuggly. This puppy, oh my God, wherever I am, it needs to snuggle right up to me. It sleeps on my chest. I mean, a lot more love coming from a dog. So it was a good trade.
It was a good trade. So now you had said I don't know if I've ever asked this before, but how did you get Seven's name as Seven?
Oh, so I was reading the Bible way back when I was religious for a moment. Just a moment. And I was going through the Bible looking for names, and his father at the time was uber religious, and I know he wanted like Matthew, Joseph, John, something like that. And I'm like, oh, I have to appease everyone. I have to come up with something religious, but knowing me, it has to be weird. So I started noticing there was all these multiple numbers of seven. Everything was in groups of seven. 7 days, seven archangels, seven horses. So I thought, that's it. It's biblical, but it's crazy. So that's where I came up. It's V. And it's the number. It's actually the number of God and the number of completeness. So it all worked out. And so he's seven, and then his middle name is Truth. So, cool. Seven Truths.
Like, and how do you spell seven?
Well, it used to be S-E-V-E-N, but whenever we go to the doctors, people go, Stephen. And I said, no, why would I leave a T out of his name? It's seven. So I got tired of people, calling him Stephen. So I just put the seven in his name. That way, I think hopefully people are still not that stupid that they can't figure out that it's seven. So
you put it, it's S-E, and then the number seven.
The number seven in place of the V, and then E-N. Yeah.
Well, that's kind of cool. That's kind of cool. You know, one person here, if he was still alive, would be proud of that, and that was Prince. Because he was a symbol for a long time.
Yeah, he was a symbol. That's true. Yeah.
So there. Now, yeah. I got that in there, I think. I don't know. I thought maybe you were thinking about the Bible because of seven deadly sins. And I don't know.
There's seven of everything. I mean, if you look through, there's seven on the seventh day, there was the seven horsemen, seven plagues, everything was sevens.
Right.
So I thought, that's a good, that way it's just good and weird, but, just kind of very tongue-in-cheek religious, not in-your-face right. religious. So.
It's V. It's yes. V stuff, yeah.
Everything gets named something, but the pets, everything gets a weird name.
That's another thing. Your dog, can I call it a dog or do you want puppy?
Yeah, okay. Dog. I mean, it's eventually going to be a dog. It was a dog. It's still a dog. It's just a puppy.
Now, how did you get the name for your dog?
Aura. So it's Aura. So I was torn because I'm a huge Star Wars fan. And I sat the day before I was going to pick her up and I'm writing all these Star Wars names. And I'm like, well, Yoda's like such a obvious name. And then I was like, Grogu is a little weird. People are probably going to mess that up. Then I thought Mando for short for Mandalorian. And I was going through. Then I started looking at my Star Wars books and finding planets, Naboo, which was kind of cute. And I'm like, okay, so is it going to be a Star Wars name or am I going to do a spiritual name? Where am I at right now? And I'm like, well, I think I'm going to do a spiritual name. So then I start writing down Amethyst and all sorts of weird things. And then all of a sudden it just came to me and I wrote down Aura, like people's aura. And I was like, that's it. It's easy. It's short, because if the name is too long for a dog, you end up shortening it and they never really run after you anyway. So, so I said, Aura, that's short. It's easy. People can remember it. It's spiritual. So we're going to go spiritual for this pet's name. No Star Wars this time. So,
gotcha. Well, you're gonna have to get another pet now so that you can.
I know. I just love naming things. That's really it. I'll go get some earthworms or something so I can just name them.
Ew.
Don't make that face. You're like, ew.
Well, no, up here we're having you said earthworms, right?
Yeah,
we're having a problem with what is the deal with it, Kimberly?
Something about them, like
they're shaky.
Yeah. The shaky worms. They're some kind of a species types of worms that they have like a shaking to them, but they're becoming, what's that word when there's so many of them?
There's like nuisance.
Infestation.
Infestation. Yeah. Something like that. So.
And they shake. They shake.
That could be a video, TikTok video.
Do you do TikTok?
No. Okay. It's so weird because I'll tell you the TikTok and I don't get the concept behind it because I put one of myself and it got like 30 views. I put one of me smashing up my old iPod and it got 800 views. So I'm like, so I need to smash up things. Apparently that's going to be like, nobody wanted to see me. They just wanted to see me destroy something. So.
Well, there you go.
Yeah. That's going to be my thing.
Well, Hopefully Matt's not going to get you mad.
Yeah, I'm smashing everything.
Okay, so snow tonight, you know, was weird because I was thinking about having you on many times before, and I asked Kimberly, I said, so what do you think for a topic? What's your thoughts? And then all of a sudden, I was looking at Facebook when I was waiting for Kimberly to come back, and then I seen this thing about somebody said something about animals on there. And then animals, and all of a sudden your face was on there. And I'm like, she's an animal? She's a V. And then I thought, well, wait a minute. We haven't talked about animals in a long time. And I thought, I know that, you know, you just got your new dog and everything, and you had to let go of your cat. So, I mean, there's things that connect us to our animals, and certain things get taken away once the animal leaves, to where when you bring in another animal, there's different, you know, the different things that come to you. So where one was taking that certain part of you and was controlling it, to where you let them go, and all of a sudden it's like there's a break in that connection. And then you get a different one, and it takes over another part that covers over that part. Do you guys follow me on this?
Yeah, sort of.
Easy for me to say.
A chalkboard out, so you know. No, but I mean, in terms of my cat, I mean, it's also an exotic cat, so it's very different. But I was so connected with my cat that if she's bored, I can feel it. And I would get like very, like, I feel like I'm responsible for her boredom. And then I'd be stressed out because I'm like, I need to find something for her to do, you know, okay. Which isn't, you know, and this is not a cat that plays with toys, really. So I'm like, oh, my God, should I get another cat? What's the deal? And then I thought, well, maybe the puppy is going to be great. You know, they're going to play and they're going to be wonderful. And that didn't happen. So then that stressed me out. I'm like, one of them has to go. And I just got the puppy. So I'm not getting rid of the puppy because the puppy's more fun. But I could feel my cat's boredom, and I always felt responsible for that. And that would stress me out, you know, right before reading. And I didn't like that. So, and then the cat, on the other hand, if I was sick, animals seem to sense or smell when you're sick or hurt. So if I was in bed for that day, she would come upstairs and lay with me and sleep next to me the whole time I was sick. You know, right. That's the only time she really seemed to interact, is she was concerned about me being sick. So there is that connection, you know, per se. But I think for me, it was even an emotional thing. You know, we could pick up on each other's emotions.
Exactly, exactly. And that's one of the things with animals, which is so interesting, is that, you know, of course, an animal can be your spirit guide, but also animals, be it new ones or old ones and stuff, can be there to help with your protection itself. Be it, if an animal has passed, they can still be your protector. And to where getting into a new animal, puppy, a kitten, anything like that, there's a piece of that animal that's no longer in your life, that has passed, that is passed down to that other animal for them to take over and to know what you need. So protections, cats, though, they claim that are the guardians of the underworld. So they're going to stand up to anything that's harsh and stuff like that. Now, dogs will do that also, but only to a point, right? Because they don't have in, what can I say? It doesn't matter if it's pit bull or Rottweiler or your dog, which is actually like a very hairy little mouse. But, you know, they're still going to be there to protect you, but they're going to be with you for you to help them. You know what I mean by that?
Right. No, and that makes sense because when I originally got the cat, which was, I guess, about 2013 or so. I'll have to look at the birth certificate. But the reason I got it was because my house was under demonic infestation and attack. And then suddenly, I mean, I was at my wit's end. You know, I had called in an exorcism guy and a demonologist, and I had actually called the Catholic Church. And they're like, we don't have time because we're so bombarded with demonic possessions. But the Catholic Church actually asked me if I wanted to work for them and help sort out and weed out some of the cases. And I'm like, I've got my own thing going on. I don't really have time to help you. Then somebody told me, hey, get a cat because cats seem to chase away demons. Mm-hmm. So I thought, well, you know, at this point, the police aren't going to help me, so I'll try anything. So that's when I decided to go and get this very expensive cat because I wanted something exotic and weird anyway. And it did start helping. I started feeling things start to mellow out and at least, you know, not interact with me as much. But it was definitely the beginning of starting to chase these things away. So if you have a demonic infestation, I highly recommend you get a few cats to keep all that. And they can also see, you know, because I realized it was funny because my puppy, when it's dark, it starts barking at the dark because I realized cats have these eyes that open up and can really see in the dark. Mm-hmm. My dog cannot see in the dark. So my dog actually, anytime there's something dark, like a hat or a shirt on the ground, it starts barking at it. So I don't think the dog can really differentiate between darkness. So I think she's kind of useless that way to let me know if there's any ghosts or anything because, you know, the cat seems to be able to sense more than the dogs.
I think when it comes to that, yeah, I think dogs just need to get to know their surroundings. She's young.
Yeah.
She's young, you know, once she gets older. You know, what's funny is that when dogs get older, their senses, even with the paranormal or anything like that, are heightened.
Yeah.
To where with kids are born with that, and then usually after 12 or 13, their minds shut down to that. Unless they're, you know, one of the ones, like if it was born into your family v. my family or Kimberly's family, since we are in the paranormal, right. That I think that's when, you know, that they'll still be in that, you know, because they're taught, you know, about it, or they can talk about it and not look frowned upon or down on and stuff, you know, like our daughter, Casey. Yeah. I know that she could still be that kid. She was much more intuitive than myself or Steph or anybody on our team if she was still with us on the team, if she didn't shut down. But yet, you know, even when she's shut down, I think that little intuitiveness still comes on her, but she'll never admit it, you know.
Right.
Yeah, you know, kind of stubborn. Like, don't you have a kid like that, Kimberly?
Yeah, all my kids have something, you know. One of them has stronger abilities than the other two, but each one has something because it's it comes from you, you know, comes from your family, comes from your grandmother, you know, it goes down the line, you know, or it'll skip a generation and then it'll be stronger for the next person, you know.
So, right. Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. And with it's funny with dogs, cats, I don't want to put spiders or snakes into it, but there's some people that really, really love them. And
yeah,
I don't know why, but anyway, that fear, when they have a certain fear and their animals with, their animal will absorb that fear and take it away. And right. I think it makes, you know, they can be heightened by that. Your guys' thought?
Oh, go ahead, Kimberly.
I think it's true. I think there is some kind of height, you know. It's so funny though, Jerry, like when you said that, well, just the other day, there was a hornet, like a huge hornet inside the here. And I was like, oh my God, do I save it or don't I save it? You know what I mean? But what if one day I get stung, you know? So I scooped it up, stuck it in a cup, you know, was able to get it in a cup. I'm like, please don't sting me. And I got it outside, you know, hoping that maybe it won't. Maybe one day it'll see me again and say, oh yeah, that's the girl that saved me, you know?
Well, you know, oh, go ahead.
I'm just saying, you know, yeah, I don't know for, I mean, there's a lot of people that are afraid to even step on spiders. They think that this should save them, right? Or a mosquito, or because they have a self-conscious about, you know, animals and stuff like that, you know? So I'm the same way. I'll save a spider.
Well, it depends on how cute it is, because if it's like an ant, if it's an ant, I think we can spare a few ants.
Right.
It, you know, it is, if it's a frog or something, or a snake even, I'll save that, turtles. But
turtles are totally different, though.
Yeah, turtles. But a mosquito, no CM, those have to go. We should kill as many as possible.
I agree with that. There's a guy that when I go to liquor store, he comes in, and one day I just happened to see his vehicle, and I said, "Hey, do you live in my building?" You know, and he's like, "Yeah." And he goes, where do you live? I said, in the basement. Ooh. And I go, do you mean, ooh, like that? He said, I used to live in the basement in that building. And he said, now that I'm up on the third floor. But he said, I woke up to a centipede walking clear across my face.
Oh,
and
no.
I'm like,
oh,
you know
no.
what? Don't you say another word, because I swear to God, I'm going to bring you outside in the back, and I'm going to beat you so bloody. I said, I don't want to hear about that, you know. But no, he's right. There is a lot of ants. There's a lot of spiders. I have one of those things in my wall, so I'm looking around right now because I'm feeling crawly. But I've only seen one centipede, and that actually came out of the vent in the ceiling in the bathroom.
Yeah,
and
you gotta watch the vent.
Yeah,
it died immediately.
Well, you know, I don't know what's going on lately, but for the last 3 weeks, I get in my car, and I they're so small. I don't know if they're spiders that have hatched somewhere in my car, but they're crawling around my dashboard. Then I got out of my car. They're crawling all over the hood of my car, everywhere.
Oh, Jesus.
So I know. And I'm like, I really don't eat in my car. If I do, I mean, I pick up every crumb. So I'm like, what the hell is this? So probably 2 hours before this show, I got the biggest blob of sage, and the whole garage is smoked out. Because I thought, well, let me try to kill them with the sage. But I've rubbed ant spray on my nice wax. I don't know what to do, but it's really freaking me out. I don't know where they came from. I wish they'd stop, but there's thousands of them on the outside and the inside of my dashboard.
What kind of car do you have?
I have a sports car.
What kind of a sports car?
A German one.
A Maserati?
No.
No, that's Italian, isn't it?
Yeah. Oh.
Yeah, Maserati's Italian.
Yeah.
It starts with a P.
Porsche.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
So it's not a good look to have a plethora of spiders.
I would just burn it.
Yeah, probably. It's a junker.
Well, don't you guys think that right now, especially right now, the way the weather's been so weird, and especially with the you know, just everything going on and stuff, because we have all these little gnat-like flying bugs.
Yeah.
Do you guys have that, Jerry, over there?
Oh, yeah, there's gnats. Yeah,
but, I mean, there's tons of them.
Like a plague of them.
Correct. I've never seen them before. You know?
I know. It may be, maybe it's throwing off the course of these, or maybe the vibration of the 5G towers, and maybe they're just being thrown off by the satellites and everything, you know, vibrationally could be happening.
Well, let's go back to the paranormal here.
Yeah.
Because I'm like,
we're on welcome to insect world.
Exactly. Okay, so
sorry.
No, that's okay. So now there are some people that actually feel that animals don't have souls.
Right.
What's your thoughts on that? Both of you.
Well, that's kind of stupid. I mean, if something is breathing and maybe they don't have thoughts or emotions, but I definitely think anything living has a soul. I think even a flower and a tree has a soul. So, of course, an animal would. It's just, I mean, it's a few steps off of what we are, but we breathe air, we live and die and give birth. So why would that not have a soul?
There's some people that don't believe that. And I remember I used to work for a veterinarian place many, many years ago when I was living in Dodge Center, Minnesota. And the doctor there believed that animals don't feel pain. And he wouldn't use very much painkiller on a cat or a dog. And sometimes, especially on cats, he wouldn't use it at all. And I mean, I couldn't stand working for this guy. He was just a horrible person. But I guess a cow got him back. He went to go work with doing some longhorns, and he got stabbed in the back. Well, no, this isn't funny now. He got look at you. You're an evil. You're laughing.
Karma is a bee. Karma is. Oh, my God.
Definitely. Yeah, he caught a horn in the back. And I guess he didn't die right away, but he did die. That's horrible to wish death on anybody, but...
I'm not laughing at that. I'm team cow.
Somebody's asking, what kind of doctor wouldn't give pain relief to an animal?
Right?
A sadistic, you know what. S-U-S-O-B.
It rhymes with a duck.
Exactly. So, yeah, no, some people claim that, you know, like they don't have souls, they don't have feelings. And that is something that, you know, Steph, good deal. What a, you know, mustard.
Yeah.
Okay, so... now, here's a big thing is the healing part. Any animal that somebody holds, unless it's a spider or a snake, that the way that it gives you their comfort is just amazing. One of the biggest ones, they say, are chimpanzees. Mm. I was reading up on it, and chimpanzees... when they give themselves to a human, they give all of themselves, all their senses, all their feelings, all their thoughts, mm-hmm. all their memories go to that person, and they kind of combine together to you know, for them to forever have that connection, which I think is really amazing on that.
Yeah. Well, I mean, there's also a lot of intelligent animals like doves and certain animals that mate for life. So they do have some sort of, you know, fidelity and faithfulness, whether it's to themselves or to a human. There's a lot of loyalty that goes within that. But I know for when I'm always thinking, because when I channel people's animals, so far most that comes through is cats and dogs, but at one point I did channel somebody's lizard, and that was the first time, and I thought, okay, well, maybe lizards go to heaven as well. But I haven't it's not like I sit and connect with earthworms on the other side, or so maybe there's a line as to what does go on the other side and continue, and then maybe some other things like insects and smaller things don't really apply as far as soul wise and reincarnating. You know, it's more of the larger animals that I seem to connect with on the other side versus smaller things. you know. So that's right. Something interesting that I found. I mean, I don't think I could connect to a butterfly on the other side. So I don't know where they go. If maybe those things that I don't connect to don't have souls and don't go on. They just simply die and then that's it.
You know, I've always wondered that because there's got to be some type of animal that just exists.
Right.
You know, but at the same time, if you take a look at it, bees, even butterflies and stuff like that, they're pollinators. So yeah. It's like there's a reason for them. So there must be a soul within them, you know, but I don't know. It's weird. Cat, there's an interesting idea. What if all spiders you've killed in your life are waiting for you on the other side? God, Cat, I love you, but oh my God.
That's a scary thought. I'm just saying.
Beyond scary. Okay, I'm going to have to go shake that off. So it's time for break. So we'll be right back in 2 minutes, everybody. Ugh.
All heard of Area 51, the U.S. government's top secret base in the Nevada desert. But have you ever heard of Area 52 or 53 or 54?
54?
How about Tonopah Test Range or the Navy's secret base inside the Bermuda Triangle? Find out about them and more in Mac Maloney's Beyond Area 51, Mysteries of the World's Most Forbidden Places. Did Richard Nixon show Jackie Gleason a crashed alien spaceship near the swamps of Florida? Is it true that more UFOs are seen over a small Scottish village than anywhere else in the world? And is there a secret place in Russia that some people think is heaven on earth? In Mac Maloney's Beyond Area 51, you'll visit more than a dozen top secret places around the globe. The haunted forests of New Jersey. A valley in Colorado where shadows come alive and humans can fly without wings. And where's the only secret base in America that's not been visited by UFOs? You've heard Mac talk all about these places on his radio show. Now you can read all about them yourself. That's Mac Maloney's Beyond Area 51, Mysteries of the World's Most Forbidden Places. Now on sale at Amazon.
For the light to shine so brightly, the darkness must be present. Tune in every Monday at 10 o'clock to Dark Sun Rising on the Para-X Radio Network.
And during the few moments that we have left, we want to talk right down to earth in a language that everybody here can easily understand.
Your source for everything paranormal, Para-X.
And we're back. This is Jerry with a calling, along with Kimberly Juarez and Mrs. V, of course. And hey, if you just tuned into the show and you're wondering what we're talking about, of course, animals, spirits, all that good stuff. And you can listen to the full show in its entirety tomorrow on www.thecallingradioshow.com, or you can go to YouTube, The Calling Radio Show, also. And remember that when it comes to entertainment of the paranormal type, Para-X is the place to be. All the different shows on there, and here I'm going to blow it again. Shauna's show is right after us. She's with Geeks Paranormal, and her show is called, I don't remember what it's called. I'm sorry. It's only been years, but anyway, and then on Tuesday nights, it's The Gathering with Stephanie and Heidi, and they have a great time. They start at 8 p.m. Central Standard Time, 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Where? Again, only on Para-X, RadioNetwork.com. Okay, and we're back. We have Valentina Lomborg, Valentina V, Mrs. V, I like to call her that. Mm-hmm. We do have a question, believe it or not, from one of our troops. And their question is, how can I get a reading from you if you want to?
Okay, You have to actually go to my website. Everything is done automated through the website there. You can book it there, and then we could do it via FaceTime, via Skype, texted. So, yeah, everything is booked through the website. And I am booked till September. So if you need anything sooner, you will have to find me on Facebook and message me, and I will do my best to squeeze you in somewhere. If it's urgent. Otherwise, if you could wait till September, then go ahead and book now, and then you'll get it for September.
What's your website?
Oh, so it is, that's a good question, psychicmediumvalentina.com. And psychic is spelled, some people cannot spell psychic, it is P-S, why?
I got it.
C-H-I-C. I can't.
No, some
people put physic, like physic. I know it's close to that. There it is. Thank you. Yes.
Well, the way I look at it is I'm a psycho, so it's got half my first.
Wow.
So I got that in there. And then you can do it Skype-wise or...
Yeah. Oh, I also have texted readings, too. It depends, you know, so... yeah, just remember the time difference. But I do have clients all over the world, so we just have to make sure we figure out the time difference.
She's in Eastern Standard Time, so there.
Yeah, thank you.
Oh, and another, wow, okay. Another one of the troops, is actually the same guy, says he's asking for one of the guys there because he doesn't have a computer or a way to listen in, is asking, have you done... cases of missing persons?
Yes, I do quite a few of those. Some of them end up good, some of them don't end up so well. I do a lot of unsolved deaths, a lot of unsolved murders. Sometimes the families cannot afford an autopsy. I go back in and channel and see what happened to the person. Sometimes there's open cases where they can't find the murderer. The police doesn't want to deal with it. I work on that as well. So those are the more unique cases. I love doing those. A lot more pressure, of course, on me because I have to be so careful as to, you know, the information I deliver. But it's all... honest information. It's just sometimes, you know, it isn't always what people want to hear. In the case of missing persons, sometimes, like last month, I did two kids, and I wrote the mother, and I said, I feel that they're still alive. Just give them time. I tuned in. I was able to find them. I went to work on it right away. Did find them energetically. They were still alive, and I think it was 11 days later, I followed up and looked on Facebook, and they had been found. So that one was, oh, thank God, you know, it ended well. But sometimes there are cases where I feel the person is deceased, and sometimes I hold back. It's hard for me because I'm supposed to deliver honest news, but sometimes I don't always want to tell them. And then there was a case where I checked in, and the woman confirmed that he was deceased and he had taken his life. And those are tough ones for me. You know, you want everything to end well, but it's not always the case. Right. But that was the long-winded version. Yes, I do.
So have you had anybody with missing pets, out of curiosity?
Yeah, I get those sometimes. And I'll take anything because I love to challenge myself. But, you know, sometimes I'm like, people desperately call me. I get thought of in the middle of the night and people are like, oh, my friend lost their cat. Can you tune in? I did find this. This was a funny one. They were desperately looking for the dog. So I tuned in. I could see the dog's surroundings where it was running around. I always have people send me a map so I can look and find where on the map I feel that the dog is so that I can give them direction. So I got like the first letter of street names. I saw the dog near this pond. So they go over there. They finally find the dog. They put the freaking dog in the car and they drove home. The dog runs out and gets lost again. Oh, no. And I'm like, I just did all this work for you. You've lost the dog again. I'm done. like that's it. One time. So yeah, you know, that was a funny. I always have some funny stories about things like that. But other times, the main thing is I always like to see if they're alive or deceased, because that gives us a starting point as to, you know, whether it's even worth looking for or we should just let it pop up later. I like to check the mentality and the emotion of the animal to see if what it's going through, because that will also give clues as to where it is. Maybe it's somewhere familiar, somewhere new. Is it with somebody else? Was it picked up? So I get as many clues as I can by tuning into the animal, and from there I can do my best. I don't always pinpoint and find animals, but if I can get people closer and in the vicinity, or at least let them know that they're still alive, then that's helpful as well.
Gotcha. Have you had anybody come to you that their pet has passed and they just want to get a connection to them?
All the time.
Really?
Here's what's weird. So when I'm doing the mediumship readings, which is generally I'm tuned into humans, for me, energetically, visually, I'm focusing, I'm talking to somebody's uncle, and all of a sudden, out of nowhere, a dog will pop into my head. And I'm like, hang on a minute. There's a dog this big, brown, white spots. Oh my God, funny. And I'm like, okay, I don't know, because I was focusing on Uncle Bob, and suddenly this literally they just come jumping into my head, and I suddenly feel the energy change, and I'm like, this is not a human. And then I see the visuals and everything. So it's almost more like a bonus. This dog wants to, or cat wants to come in and just say, hey, I made it to the other side. And I'll usually see them playing or jumping around. They feel really happy. Now, I did have one client last year. I kept feeling it was a baby. I'm like, oh my God, this woman lost her baby, baby, baby. And everything I'm saying, she's, you know, confirming. And then she pulls out, almost near the end, she pulls out a collar. And I'm like, I thought this was a baby. And she goes, it is my baby. And so, so I got so confused, because I've been tuning into what feels energetically like a little human baby. But this woman couldn't have children, so she treated the animal like a baby. Oh. It had a bassinet, and she took it everywhere, and she dressed it up. And so I was like, wow. I was a little confused, because I thought, I messed this up. I got it wrong. But I didn't get it wrong. It's just that it came across as a baby. And so she spent a whole hour visiting with us, and she was really, really happy. And that's probably the longest I've ever spent with a pet, you know, because she just really needed it. She was so heartbroken. I mean, this pet and her were everything. And so I didn't mind, and I was surprised at how much information I got. It showed me its favorite places, you know. I was getting, because when I do animals, I mean, it's not like they're going to sit there and go, oh, I love Gravy Train, and you know, it isn't going to be communicating. Right. I'm just going to get feelings and some visuals. Maybe I see their toys, or I get an idea of what they used to do, or their personality. So it's a lot different, you know. In my terms, I have to work a lot harder to get really detailed information, as far as, you know, because there isn't much to latch onto. It's the same when I connect with babies. They're not going to have a big vocabulary. It's just going to be very short and sweet. And so same with animals. I tend to get dogs probably 70% of the time more than cats. I don't know why.
Because cats don't care.
Cats are like, screw you. No, I'm done. I'm on to my next life. I don't need you. Yeah, it is interesting, but it is more dogs, you know. And then that one iguana I got that one time.
Oh, an iguana. God. Okay.
She wanted to know what killed it. And so I went in and I took over the iguana, and I was like, you left it out in the sun. I'm feeling my skin peeling. And she's like, yes, I did. And I was like, okay. But that was the first and only time. I was like, whoa, I can connect with iguana.
So out of curiosity. So in a way, by her leaving it out and its skin was going and stuff like that, so she kind of like fried it, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So now, could they have revenge and want to then haunt that former owner that neglected them?
No, I've never, at the end when we all convert, there's really no anger. That kind of thing doesn't exist. And so even for the animal accepts and knows it's dead. It feels like it's having a better time than it did down here. So whatever caused the death, there's never any anger, I'm going to get back to you. It's very accepting. You know, it's just okay. That this was how the animal or person, this is the end of their journey.
Oh, I was really kind of hoping you were going to have a story like, yeah. Awesome. Yeah. That's hilarious.
Her suntan lotion caught on fire. No.
Oh, no. You know, and that dog you talked about in the bassinet and stuff, was that an Irish wolfhound?
Oh, I love those. No, it was like one of these little, not a foofy one like mine, but just a smaller one that just, you know, it's hard when, you know, because I'm also picking up the human's emotions as I'm doing this. And it's just, sometimes I'm crying on the inside, you know, for these people. I can't show it on the outside because I have to maintain. But, you know, there's a part of me that always puts myself in the other person's shoes. And I'm like, man, I can't imagine. I hate this, you know. And then there's also the healing. I really try to move people past that. And I think it's so important because what I do allows people to be okay with that. They didn't just, they're completely wiped off the earth. They're continuing, but in another realm. So, right. You know, it does help them a little bit to know that they're still alive, but maybe not here in this realm, but they're still alive. And I think that's, you know, speaks volumes. It's very important for people because then the connection continues. The connection is never cut off. They're just not here, but they can still connect. And I teach people to feel the animals and, you know, you might even hear them walk through the hallway or in this case here, segueing into another story. When I moved to Hawaii, I was laying on the bed and suddenly I was woken up by little feet on the bedspread. And I woke up and I was like, oh my God, I know I don't have a pet. And so as I'm thinking all this, I feel the little animals circle around like a dog would, you know, when they're trying to get the perfect spot, and then plop down behind me. And right as it does that, the sheet over me pulls tighter. So at this point, I'm like laying wide awake going, I know when I turn, there's going to be nothing there, but I have felt everything. I heard the sound of the footsteps on the blanket. I am freaking out right now. So finally, I turn around, I put my hand there, and there's nothing. So that was the beginning of the first time I realized that animals can, ghost animals, whatever this was, a ghost dog. I felt it was a dog, not a cat. And I did have another Yorkie that had passed. So I'm thinking maybe that one found me all the way in Hawaii and decided to curl up. And I never felt it again. It was just that one little moment. There was enough clues that I now have experienced a ghost dog and know that it can manipulate things in this realm. I heard the sound of the feet, and when it laid down, there was weight across, you know, and pulled my blanket tight across me. So that opened up a whole, you know, more theories of things and just really got me thinking that just like ghosts of humans, they can come back and actually do very real things, materialistically in this realm.
Right. Well, you know, we had Lolita was the first cat we ever had, and she was a feral cat, and she was brought back from Friday Harbor, Washington, and then she was such a sweet little peanut, and then we had Bobo, which, if I'm correct, she was born and lived, I think her mother was feral, and they lived in a burned-out building, and it was extremely cold. And then we got Zoe, we call her Zoe. It was a poor cat. She was such a sweet pea, and the other cats just didn't like her. So she gained weight tremendously. And when she would walk across the floor, you would hear the floorboards creak. She was that big, and she was so cuddly and so cute and everything. But she passed away not too long ago. Now, when I moved here, one of the things that I took with me was one of the cat's toys, and it's like a little owl thing that has these little feathers, and you hang it on the doorknob. Now, sometimes in the middle of the night, and it seems like whenever it's an anniversary of one of their deaths, I will wake up to the sound of it being played with, because it's got little bells on it, and my hearing is really horrible. I have the worst hearing. I shouldn't even be a paranormal investigator because, I can hear the dead voice, but I can't hear, you know, if somebody else is talking and stuff. I'll hear that, and I'll look over, and it'll be changed and stuff like that. So, and I also think too, a lot of it has to do with, now we're going back to the animal connection again, is that recently, actually, Steph has been gotten me to go see the owls. And the owls, there's a mama, papa, and she's got three little babies. And it's weird is that going to see them and how much I collect from them. Like the other day, they had moved into an owl or a squirrel's nest, which I always thought it's really small because these owls are pretty big, you know. And I thought they only had one baby because I only seen one, and it was right on the lip of the thing. And I thought, oh, my God, if this poor thing falls, you know, it's probably going to be dead, you know. A storm came, and then the next morning, Steph had told me that the baby fell out of it. And so they came out, the baby's fine, and they had to replace the nest. So, and I thought that was quite amazing that they can do that, and the mother would allow it, you know. So they put all three babies in this, it's like a see-through one, it's mesh, and they have it up there, and you can actually see it, and there is three babies. I went out there with my camera, I was taking some photos, and the photos were so cool because all of a sudden you see this one baby, he kind of like staring at me, and then he does the head bobbing thing, you know. And I thought, this is so sweet. Then I looked down at my camera and it says error 2. It wiped out everything, all the pictures that I had taken. It was like, oh, so maddening, you know. It was crazy. But, you know, it's so weird is that when it comes to the spirit of certain animals, cats definitely have a different thing that they give you. Dogs give you more of a secure and safe type thing, where cats give you a secure too, but it's more of your fears of your fears.
The ethereal. I feel like maybe, I mean, dog sense ghosts as well, but it's more like dogs protect actual things you can see, like the humans, physical, you know. Yeah, they will go and go after a bad guy, but the cats handle the unseen. And that goes back to my theory, because suddenly it hit me last week. Cats' eyes, you know, can see. They can open up and see in the dark, whereas dogs just have regular pupils like us, so they can't really see that much. In fact, I think they see in black and white.
Yeah.
You know? So, I mean, really, every household should have one of each for both things, so you are protected too, across the board.
Yep.
But, yeah, I mean, cats serve a purpose. I mean, Lyra used to just sit. I'd be watching TV because I love watching horror movies when Matt's at work. I turn all the lights off and one candle, and I watch horror movies. because it's a psychological thing. You can either sit and freak out, or you can tell yourself I'm perfectly fine. So I like to watch horror movies with all the lights off. And I'll sit, and all of a sudden Lyra is staring at the stairs behind me. And I'm like, what is it you see? And then I'm like, well, do I need to get my camera? Is it something we need to photograph? You know, don't leave me hanging. But then, you know, she stares and then she's done. And I'm like, okay, I don't know what that was, but it's gone anyway. But that's like our thing, you know. But it'll be interesting to see what the dog picks up, if anything, because she barks at the gardener, she barks at a baseball hat. So I'm not sure the dog is going to be very good paranormal companion there.
Well, she's little too. She's a little thing. But one of the things I did want to say about the owls, though, the owls kind of teach you independence, you know, of accepting what's happening now and to roll with everything, where the the Papa Owl, as we call it, will sit there and be the guardian of everything around, while the mother really keeps an eye on the babies and like a crow was to go past, that mother is, right. Eyeballing it, something fierce, And without even doing anything, I noticed that the last time I was there today, a crow made its way pretty close to him. We're sure her eyes were open. And when I looked over at Papa had his eyes shut, but then all of a sudden I'm watching him and I know that she's watching and this crow's getting closer. All of a sudden his eyes open and he just this cold stare going to that bird, like, you are 2 inches away from me coming and crushing your life, is what he's saying. And then it was so funny because then he flew away and stuff. And then Mama looks over at him with this look like, okay, he was within 30 feet. Why didn't you kill him? Type of a look. And what did he do? Faced the sun and closed his eyes.
And smoked a cigar. No.
Pretty much, yeah. So it's just so amazing on all that stuff. And, as a human myself, trying to...
You're human?
I'm kind of human. I'm a human, according to cats and dogs. My human. what was I going to say now? V, you and your giggle.
Sorry.
That's okay.
You said you were human.
Yeah. A lot of people didn't know that. trying to... actually do that, but I still have some kind of blockage, and I really would like to get a pet. The closest thing I have to a pet, I still got Melly over there, the Bassador.
Yeah. But,
one thing that I kind of claim as my pet is this mallard that comes around, and I thought that its mate was killed. She's nesting. She's nesting behind the garage. So it's like, that is so cool. I didn't know that. So he comes out, and I'm sure that the babies will be coming out and coming down here, because I'll put out things like I'll take leftover corn and stuff and throw it out there. Mm-hmm. Oh, my God, he just thinks it's the greatest thing in the world. And I'll do the same with nature bars.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of funny on how
is it just because they're called nature bars?
No, it's because granola and stuff, it's good for you. That's all I got to throw him. He doesn't like chocolate chips.
Well, duh.
No, I
don't. I was gonna say chocolate chips.
But no, I'm thinking, I don't know, maybe one day getting a kitty or something,
yeah, you owe it to yourself.
Yeah, I would get an older one, though. That's been, go to a place, and if they say, it's been here now for 2 years.
Yeah.
Yeah, it looks like you're going home with me, buddy. As long as it's a female. I don't like male cats.
I don't like male anything. Yeah, they pee on
anything. As a matter of fact, they pee on anything.
I gotta make him transgender. No. No, I just mean, every puppy I've ever always had, I always get a girl. Because they spray and pee and all that. It's
they
a
do.
Peeing thing.
Yep.
Yeah.
Oh, V, gosh, we're going to get ourselves in trouble. I think we're borderline right now. It's close. We got 1 minute left. So again, how people can get a hold of you, it's www.psychicmediumvalentina.com.
Yeah.
Or they can go to your, do you have a special Facebook page?
Yeah. It should be Psychic Medium Valentina. I'll put my Instagram too. There's probably a little more action on that. I have to put here at... I'll just type it in here. Okay. Oh, at the Danish Medium. I'm sorry.
Gotcha.
Might be on the chat. So, okay.
There you go. Oh, yeah. At Danish Medium. That's right.
Yeah, one of these days I might go live on Facebook for a couple hours and do readings. But, you know, it's I always think about it and then I go to bed. I have big dreams and then I'm wiped out by the end of the day. So yeah, one of these days I am. I really would think that would be such a blast.
There you go. There you go. Well, well, thank you all for listening. Kim, you didn't get much time in. Next time, I promise you.
She just sat and looked beautiful.
She did. She did. She always does.
Yes.
So, and thank you all for listening. We appreciate it. Thank you, Para-X. And thank you, Sarge. You're the greatest in the world.
Thank you, Sarge.
Thank you,
all the troops for listening.
Thank you, troops.
We'll see you all next week. Oh my God, she's a wild animal, folks. We'll see you all next week and have yourself a great week. Bye.